Thus far, we've been studying the Sprachmalerei of prophetic speech, the deeds of the gods, resounding in the Omphalos, pouring out from the mouths of poets who've ascended atop the peak of the mound, with devoted thoughts thinking back to what is to be thought. We'd given this prophetic speech the name Sandhya Bhasha, the esoteric or secret language. So in the next few lectures, we're going to meditate on the nature of gods, as it finds expression in this esoteric language, thus formally defining for ourselves the word God, our method of etymology, and the role of negation in both theology and ontology. Now the lectures which follow are going to be extremely dense, so I'll recommend strictly adhering to the verb roots rather than their imagery as we journey along. We have already seen that the word for God in Greek is theos, which was derived from a root bearing the sense to put and place, from which we also derived our English words do, deed, thesis, word, verb, fashion, fact, festival, and feast, and dhatu, that is the outcome of a setting down, our verb root in Sanskrit. The word prophecy, the primal speech of Brahma, derives from a root bearing the sense to shine, glow, speak, and to say, from which we derive our English words beacon, focus, and fame, and our Greek word phano, meaning to show, uncover, reveal, to shine and appear, from which we derive the words epiphany, phenomena, and the Greek word phatagio, which means to show and make visible, from which we derive the words phantasia, fantastic, fantasy, fancy, and the word phantom. The Sanskrit equivalent to our word prophecy, based purely on the etymology, is pratibha, a flash of understanding, intuitive awareness, and inspiration. Now we'll develop a highly technical understanding around this term, as it will be the vehicle by which the gods manifest. Now this motif of visual imagery coupled to divine speech shouldn't be surprising, since our desire here is to forsake up the stimma of being, zuhuran. The words vision and view are derived from the Latin word video, thus the word video, all of which come from our familiar root vid, to know and to see, from which we derive our words wise and wisdom, vidya, Veda, history, and idea. We were surprised to learn that this root gave us the Greek word eidos, that which is seen, and the word eidolon, a phantom or form. Now since phantom, as we saw, was shown, uncovered, and revealed, the word idol is understood to be God, revealing himself or herself to the poet. Unsurprisingly then, the word Hades is also derived from this root with the addition of the negation root. Thus, that which is unseen, invisible, hell, the underworld, and the formless. But Plato, who is thought by many to have refuted this etymological method of derivation in his dialogue, The Cratylus, gives us another etymological derivation of the word Hades, writing that the name Hades is not in the least derived from the invisible, Aides, but far more probably from knowing, Evene, knowing all noble things. And for that reason, he was called Hades by the Nomothetes, the law or namesetter. First, we see that in spite of having dismissed the method of etymology, Plato, in fact, has reproduced the method by appealing to another word that is derived from the very same root bearing the sense of knowing and seeing. Thus he says that Hades is named as such because he knows all noble things. Instead of being associated with the unseen, Plato reinterprets Hades, or perhaps we could say further elaborates on the nature of Hades as the all-seeing or knowing God, much like his philosopher. It's noteworthy here to see that the word for law-setter is nomothetes, consisting of two roots. The first, nomos, which we saw last lecture, relates to the act of naming or summoning something to court. And the second here, our word, phithimi, to put, place, and set in motion, which shares in the root of our word, theos, God. Thus the setter of the law invokes for us the imagery of the gods setting down a melody, like our poets do with their articulate and clear speech. Thus it is no coincidence here that our poet is to be known as a god. And indeed Plato continues by commenting on the power of Hades to use speech to keep beings bound in the underworld through their own desires. That all others have been overcome by his enchantments, so beautiful as it appears are the words which Hades has the power to speak. And from this point of view, this theos is the perfect sophist. Now the etymology of the word sophist, meaning clever, skillful, able, and wise, is uncertain, though we will attempt to narrow it down in the later lectures. But a potential link to the word saphis, speaking clearly, has been proposed. So it's not surprising to see Plato call Hades the perfect sophist from the perspective of his power to speak articulately and clearly. But Plato famously juxtaposes the sophistication of the poets with that of the philosophers in his dialogues. Summarized in his utterance, there is an old quarrel between philosophy and poetry. Now much ink has been spilt to renegotiate a relationship between Platonic philosophers and Homeric poets, and perhaps we can return to this supposed dichotomy later. But for now, based purely on the invocation of words, we can say that the philosopher, in name, is friend of clear speech, a lover of divine poets, and the darling of prophets and theologians, the mouths of Hades, the knower of all noble things. Now, why the gods are idols is an intuition we'll build up from the foundations with etymology, beginning with the observation that the root vid is extended from our familiar root vi, to turn, bend, and wind, which gave us our words wine, vine, and the Sanskrit vayati, to spin and weave. Now if we make an anadrome of this root vid, we get the root div, bearing the sense to shine, glow, and to be bright. This root gives us the words deity, meaning a god, the word divine, divination, journey, journal, Zeus, and the Sanskrit root div, meaning to praise, rejoice, shine, sport, gamble, throw, and to cast dice, and jyot, meaning to shine, glitter, illuminate, manifest, express, and clarify. The first of these roots gives us the Sanskrit word deva, a god, and the second of these roots gives us jyotis, meaning light and brightness, a word also used to describe astronomy, the study of the shining ones in heaven. The first point we note here is that the sense which our root for the word prophecy bears is like that of the root which gives us our word deity, namely to shine and to glow. So we can say that the hero's journey is thus necessarily a vision quest, but consists not just of any view, but those wherein the gods are brought out from Hades as idols, from knowing to seeing, like Brahma pouring from his mouth Soma, the cosmic eulogy, Om. Now to appreciate the relation between gods and idols, let us invoke the words of the poet Homer, who in the epic, the Odyssey, invokes Athena, goddess of neuroscience, who bears the mind of a god. The context of the verse is renowned, wherein Queen Penelope, daughter of Icarius, awaits the return of her beloved husband and king of Ithaca, Odysseus, who had left to fight in the infamous Trojan War. During his absence of 20 years, Queen Penelope remained faithful to her husband King, and delayed marrying other suitors. Thus Penelope is perpetually in the threshold state, betwixt and between marriage and widowhood. In an episode, Penelope laments her liminal condition, and Homer reifies her state, situating her in the upper chambers, the most inner and private section of the royal palace wherein only the women reside, which we saw last lecture was the yoni. In the silent recess of night, restless Penelope dreamt a nightmare, and the goddess Athena, via an epiphany, made an eidolon, an idol, in the queen priestess's poetic vessel. In fact, the Sanskrit word for the sacrificial altar, the pedestal, is the vedi, thus narrowing our sense here that the vessel of the poet is the site wherein prophecy reverberates. Note here that the word used by Homer to describe Athena's actions is poesy, which is no coincidence here, since we are now well equipped to interpret the intentions of a mind of a god in healing their devotee, by presenting her a fantastic idol amid the storm of her hellish nightmare, her vessel tossing between two extremes, between womanhood and widowhood. It is by mere fact of this act, poesy, that the fathers and the mothers of old named the poet God, our hero and husband to Mnemosyne, father of the Muses, and birther of Athena, Zeus the Deva. And it is precisely within this vessel named Penelope, meaning she from whose mouth is woven the sacred mysteries, whilst betwixt and between, poetess and priestess, queen of Ithaca, an island in between, not unlike that which birthed our Dvaipayana, that the mind of God appeared as a fantastic idol. Now this idol is said to have been in the form of a gynaeke, a woman, which is a word that comes from a root bearing the sense of a woman or female, and it gives us our words queen and the Sanskrit word gna, which means wife, speech, voice, goddess, and ascetic priestess. Now, keeping this imagery in mind, we find that Athena appeared to Penelope as Iphthime, her sister, who as queen of Phrae bears a form worthy of one who may enter the woman's only upper chambers of the palace, the yoni of the kingdom, the reproductive vessel of the kingdom itself, wherein rests and digests the queen and divine poetess. It is keeping with this imagery that I have taken the poetic liberty to define the word queen as yogini, an ascetic priestess, a name worthy of she who is wedded to our priest king Odysseus, a name meaning master of twists and turns. Now this ability of Homer to weave multiple layers of imagery with the utterance of a few simple words is likely what led Plato to call Homer the poet of poets. But it may have also afforded him the sense that not everyone was capable of partaking in the prophecies and poetics, and so to mark off the darlings of the poets, the law-setter must have yoked together and fashioned for them the name philosophers. For even according to Plato in his Cratylus, "But observe, Socrates, that most of the names we have examined signify motion." "What if they do, Cratylus? Are we to count names like votes and determine their correctness that way? If more names signify motion, does that make them the true ones?" "No, that's not a reasonable view." "It certainly isn't, Cratylus. So let's drop this topic and return to the one that led us here." Thus it seems Plato's philosopher is himself bound by Hades' enchantments of a meta-language like mathematics, counting objects instead of getting to the root, the motions of the object language. For Plato to only drop the topic when the words became verbs is characteristic of much of Platonic dreaming. Now the question remains, in Homer's depiction of the Epiphany, was the phantom of Iphthime a goddess herself and thus an idol? Or is the goddess formless and thus invisible? And if the divine artisans, the gods, are formless, how then are we to make sense of their existent footprints in prophecy? This lecture is going to set up the framework to answer these questions. We'll further the imagery of the imagination and the poet's vessel in the next few lectures. It's fitting here to invoke a hymn of Atri, the father and devourer of Soma, to the Vishvedeva, the divine artisans, in our discussions about the happenings of the poet's vessel. A note here, that the first word of Vishvedeva, Vishva, which we saw in an earlier lecture, meant all clans, and derives from a root bearing the sense to settle, enter, and be absorbed within, and gives us our English words village and the Sanskrit root vish, meaning to pervade, settle upon, and enter into. Now we'll return to this imagery of entering into the poet's vessel, and it being related to the village and home of all beings shortly. But first we hear from the Shtimma. Āno mahim marmatim sajo shag nam devim namasārāta havyam madhor madhaya prihatim hitignyam agne vahapatir bihi devayanehi. Hither to us, in agreement with her, bring magnificent devotion, Queen Goddess, on whom the oblation is bestowed with reverence, the lofty knower of truth, for the exhilarating drink of honey, bring her hither, Agni, along the paths the gods travel. Here we see the word Gna invoked alongside the word Devim, further qualifying our insight that Gna is divine Vak, the goddess speech herself, whom Agni is being asked to invoke within the Yoni, upon whom the oblation is bestowed with reverence. The word Armati means obedience, devotion, and commitment, not unlike that of Penelope towards her marriage and towards the gods, and comes from our familiar root, R. With this insight, we can extend the meaning of Arya to include Queen, the supreme aristocrat, and Lady Dawn herself, our high priestess of divine poetry, Oracle of Delphi, whose medicinal speech pours upon the wounds of the fallen, anointing them with a sacrificial pact worthy of being betwixt and between gods and men. Now such a pact is reminiscent of the god Iris, the rainbow, whose promise to pour and keep the vessels of artisans and artificers filled with the exhilarating drink of honey keeps them obedient and devoted to the thoughts thinking back to what is to be thought. The motif of pots of gold at the ends of rainbows is certainly gesturing towards the divinely inspired speech, woven with twists and turns to keep the kernels of truth covered and protected against philosophers that fail to sing and name their muses. Now in this regard, Jameson and Brereton note that further the middle verse of this hymn, excluding the repeated verses at the end, verse 7 is directed not towards a god, but a ritual implement, the Garma pot, used in the Pravargya ritual and often the focus of priestly speculation. Now this verse occurring before the 7th invokes for us the Garma pot, the womb, the vessel, and the focus of priestly speculation, wherein the idea becomes manifest as idol through clear and articulate formulas. So let us explore the words we give to these idols as they are invoked in our vessels. Now, before we set sail into the midspace, I'd suggest we take up some words of caution from Dante to the philosophers as they navigate the sea of poets. In the second canto of Paradiso, he says, "O ye, who in some pretty little boat, eager to listen, have been following behind my ship that singing sails along, turn back to look again upon your shores. Do not put out to sea, lest peradventure, in losing me, you might yourselves be lost. The sea I sail has never yet been passed. Minerva breathes, and pilots me Apollo, and Muses nine point out to me the bears. Well may you launch upon the deep sea salt your vessel, keeping still my wake before you upon the water that grows smooth again." Now Robert Durling notes that the first set of verses here already hint at the expectation of the reader being competent. As he writes, the Italian barca is singular here, but its sense is distributive. Each little bark is an individual, unprepared reader, while the poet is a large ship, a legno. As line 14 makes clear, both groups of readers are thought of as sailing in small boats. Now the word legno derives from the Latin word lignum, meaning firewood and tree, itself from a root bearing the sense to gather, collect, and to speak precisely, a sense we've seen shared with the roots for poetry and sophist, and gives us our words legend, lecture, and lesson. From this root, we also derive the word logos, meaning speech, oration, discourse, a quote, a story, a study, a ratio, a word, calculation, and reason, and thus logic, and the suffix logia, a disciplined study of something. And if we add to this root another bearing the sense of in, inner, within, and inside, we get our word intellect, meaning to understand, or more literally, the inner speech. Thus far, we've been studying the way etymological roots play a significant role in organizing and explaining both the underlying verb ontology and the symbolic logic that's employed by poets to describe the nature of their own inspiration, their meaning-making. The words etymology and ontology derive from the same root, bearing the sense to be, from which we derive our words is, essence, and soothe, meaning to verify and prove. We saw this root give us the Sanskrit root us and the word sat. In Greek, we get the word eimi, to be, exist, and to live, whose present particle, on, meaning actual and real, gives us our word ontos, meaning really and truly. If we add to this word our root for logos, we get the word ontology, which in keeping with the invocation of the poets, we can say, are the poetic legends of being. Now similarly, we derive the Greek word etheos, meaning true, genuine, real, and right. Thus, etymos, meaning true, real, sure, and genuine, and etymon, the true sense of a word. Again, adding the root of the poet's wooden vessel, we get etymology, which we can call lessons on being poetic. Now to exercise the noose, to weave the legends and lessons is serious work. And Durling reminds us again, in commenting on Dante's warning, that the first 9 verses are addressed to the first group of readers, those not trained in philosophy and theology, and therefore not equipped to follow the poet. If they lose his meaning, they'll be lost at sea. Whoever fishes for the truth and lacks the art fares much worse than in vain when he leaves the shore, for he does not return the same as before. Commenting further, this passage is unique in the comedy in explicitly distinguishing 2 groups of readers with differing levels of competence. This was in part anticipated in the Inferno, and in counseling less qualified to read no further. Only readers who acquired early training in philosophy and theology are encouraged to continue, and they are cautioned to pay close attention, that is, to sail close behind the poet's vessel. Both apostrophes are formulated in terms of the traditional trope of the composition of poetry as a sea voyage. It should be said that ontology and etymology are the most sophisticated of the disciplines in Athena's Hecademe, since they belong to Mnemosyne, mother of the muses. Recall Hesiod, emitting the voice of the gods, declaring the words of the divine muses, "We know how to say many deceptive things looking like genuine things, but we also know how, whenever we wish it, to proclaim things that are true." Which is reason alone to be cautious when partaking in language and speech when studying ontology and etymology. First, we note that the muses reserve the right to speak in a manner that can either be true or deceptive. If, as the Platonic philosophers argue, the poets are to be blamed for deception, their criticism is misplaced, and therefore unlawful, for they too partake in the creative acts of reception, conception, perception, and deception too. The root for these words bears the sense to seize and grab, giving us the Latin word captio, to take, seize, storm, to hold and to contain, from which we derive the words have, capture, catch, chase, capable, anticipate, participate, accept, intercept, inception, and occupy. We get the word receive, meaning to take, to host guests, to allow, and to understand. The word conceive, to develop, to form in mind, to imagine, and to bear a child. To perceive, meaning to be aware, to understand, and to interpret. And deception, to trick, mislead, and to take captive. Now this sense is preserved in the words latent and lull, meaning to soothe, to put to sleep, and to howl, bearing the sense to conceal, hide, deceit, to bark, and to howl. We derive the Greek word lithos, meaning concealment and forgetfulness, which when negated gives us the word alephis, unconcealed, unforgotten, true, real, and genuine. What's interesting to us here is that the sense of lithos is shared by Hades, whose sophisticated speech lulls even the desires of the sirens. But interestingly, this reveals to us the insight that aletheia is always accompanied by well-formed forms, or idols like Athena did for Penelope, and that the site of inception, conception, and perception is the same as that of deception, due solely to the will of the muses. And another word for this site is derived from the same root, meaning head, bowl, and cup, giving us the words head, cap, cape, chief, and the Sanskrit word kapala, a skull, a bowl, or our poet's vessel. Now this is entirely in line with some philosophic intuitions that the head is the site of anticipation, inception, participation, reception, conception, perception, and deception. And having invoked the etymologies of perception and ontology, it's only appropriate to invoke the phantom of Bishop Berkeley, who famously declared that neither our thoughts nor passions nor ideas formed by the imagination exist without the mind, is what everyone will allow. It is true that Mnemosyne, mother of the muses, memory, and mind, is essential to have thoughts, passions, ideas, and images, such that if we imagine mind-independent things, we remain within the musings of Mnemosyne's muses. So the philosopher Berkeley continues with confidence that their esse is percipi, or that the essence of mind-independent things is to be perceived. And it was with this utterance that the bishop too entered the ranks of idealism, and rightfully so, since all ideas and idols are known and seen if the muses so choose to remind us. Now there are several ways we can take Berkeley's formula here. Esse is percipi. The one I'd like to consider here, in keeping with our goal of learning our etymologies, is the case wherein the muses, daughters of Mnemosyne, are capable of both deception and perception. As in when thoughts of oases and deserts lead to visions guiding one further into the desert, or mistaking the passions of thirst for hunger and overeating, or when the idea of compassion results in a failure to act in a just manner, only to remain situated in the further perpetuation of injustice. So, if we are to speak of their essence in matters of ontology, would it not be more accurate to restate the formula then, as their esse is discipi? That is, their esse is to be deceived? This would certainly align his dualism with the poetic intuition that Mnemosyne's sister, Lemosyne, or forgetfulness, from Lithi, whose name captures the same sense as our word deception, is juxtaposed to the idea and eidolon of Elephis, the unconcealed and unforgotten. In fact, the poets say that those who drank from the river Mnemosyne would become all-knowing, like Hades, but those who drank from Lemosyne would simply forget and keep repeating their deceptions. Even Plato spoke, in keeping with the forgetfulness of the passion for thirst, that those who were not saved by wisdom drank more than was necessary, and each one, as he drank, forgot all things. Thus mind-independent things are the forgotten things, and as Dante reminds us, turn back to look again upon our shores, and that in losing me, you yourself might be lost. This speech suggests to me the fact that those seeking to articulate the realm of the mind-independent should heed caution in their utterances, lest they lull themselves into latency again with the wrong soothsayers. This is but an old quarrel between philosophers and poets. So if the essence of the unintelligible thing was to be perceived, then we would express contradiction and deception within the logos of our ontology. In this sense, every perception is ontology, but not everyone is equally as perceptive. Not everything received and conceived by the imagination in the head is ontology, and this fact is well known through etymology. We might declare more generally that the esse of mind-independent things is kepi, to be captured. Now, what form this general idea takes is something we'll explore in much depth later, but thus far we have been speaking of Sprachmalerei, speech painting, or how to capture imagery with words, and how words capture verbs by etymology. So when the poet Hesiod invokes muses in relation to etymon and aletheia, to the genuine and the true, we should bear in mind that popular formulas like esse is percipi, though invoking a sense of perception, as in when they say, I understand what he means when he says that, can be deceptive. The fact of our capacity to know and see such a difference speaks volumes to the general formula, esse is kepi. In fact, much of the playful phrases I have been using here, and will continue to as we learn to become familiar with our etymological roots and their imagery, are not meant to deceive or make simplicities complicated, but to remind us of the necessity of memory when meditating on manners of ontology with words. For they will be deceptive if they are not understood as verbs, but as mere elements of a meta-language to work on. Meditating again on the mantra, esse is percipi, and attending its etymology, we could consider the overlap of senses between the words percipi and to precipitate. That is to throw or hurl down, headlong, hastily, and in an unrestrained manner, as if being thrown out of the garden and into a godforsaken realm of brutes and beasts. For it can be said that only brutes and beasts pit poets and philosophers against each other, hoping to perceive the good for themselves while they both duel. And if mnemosyne serves me well, behold, for I was captured in lawlessness, and a sinner when my mother conceived me. Indeed, this imagery of thrownness into Dasein, into being, is familiar to our academics, and ranks highly within their legends of being human. But as muses are sure to remind the sinners, both poet and philosopher drink from the same stream. They are home in the same house. The word home comes from a root bearing the sense to settle and dwell, via the German Heimas, meaning home, village, and settlement. We also derive the Sanskrit root kshi, meaning to dwell, abide, stay, reside, remain, and inhabit. And the words kshema, meaning a basis, foundation, residing and resting, and kshetra, meaning a field, or a cultivated land, some cultivated soil, or a cultivated ground. Now, if we add to this root our familiar root for royal, the devoted thought surging back to what is to be rightfully thought, we get our word America. As the Bard of the Americas, Walt Whitman, once penned, the Americas of all nations at any time upon the earth have probably the fullest poetical nature. The United States themselves are essentially the greatest poem. Here is not merely a nation, but a teeming nation of nations. Here Whitman employs a metaphor to link the nation-state with the poem, since both are composed of elements, which when properly ordered and organized, produce a whole far more worthy than the sum of its parts. He continues, to its poets, the other continents arrive as contributions. He gives them reception for their sake and his own sake. His brain is the ultimate brain. He is no arguer, he is judgment. He judges not as the judge judges, but as the sun falling around a helpless thing. And he sees the farthest, he has the most faith. His thoughts are the hymns of the praise of things. And with such faith in the poetics, Whitman and fellow bearers of the Kapala, like Emerson, transubstantiated the United States into a Platonic vessel called the Republic. And the head of this vessel, bearing cape and cap, the captain, was soon reminded of the fate of Socrates. O captain, my captain, our fearful trip is done. The ship has weathered every rack, the prize we sought is won. The port is near, the bells I hear, the people all exulting, while follow eyes the steady keel, the vessel grim and daring. But O heart, 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 O the bleeding drops of red, where on the deck my captain lies, fallen cold and dead. A tragedy, penned in remembrance for the fallen captain. For with this legend, the divine muses remind us of their capacity to deceive. So we are to never forget the existence of brutes and beasts in our home called humanity. Like Socrates crying out in remembrance to Asclepius, Odysseus too ultimately died by forgetting the nature of his own family. The lesson of such legends of being is that the Platonic vessel is forever tragic, even if the helpless thing juxtaposes poets against philosophers. So we take with us the reminder of high priests. In losing me, you yourself might be lost. Now poetics are a treacherous kshetra, sacred ones even more so, and they will make many deceptive things look like genuine ones. For it wasn't the logos of sophists, priests, and poets that committed the first sin. But once he precipitated, his esse was precipi. To appreciate the role of language in the poetic imagination of poets like Whitman, we can resort to the words of more recent scholars like Benedict Anderson. In his now well-known book, Imagined Communities, Anderson gives his account on the emergence of nationalism in the post-industrial revolution world, paying attention to the role of print media and the emergent literacy of the masses in imagining their own pasts. Naturally, since both media and literacy are lulled by Lamosony and awakened by Mnemosony, Anderson titles his 11th chapter, Memory and Forgetting, writing, "In Europe, the new nationalisms almost immediately began to imagine themselves as awakening from sleep, a trope wholly foreign to the Americas. Already in 1803, the young Greek nationalist, Adamantios Choreis, was telling a sympathetic Parisian audience, 'For the first time, the Greek nation surveys the hideous spectacle of its ignorance and trembles in measuring with the eye the distance separating it from its ancestors' glory.'" Here is perfectly exemplified the transition from new time to old. For the first time, still echoes the ruptures of 1776 and 1789, but Correia's sweet eyes are turned, not ahead to San Martin's future, but back, in trembling, to ancestral glories. It would not take long for this exhilarating doubleness to fade, replaced by a modular, continuous awakening from a chronologically gauged AD-styled slumber, a guaranteed return to an aboriginal essence. Undoubtedly, many different elements contributed to the astonishing popularity of this trope. For present purposes, I would mention only two. In the first place, the trope took into account the sense of parallelism out of which the American nationalisms had been born, and which the success of the American nationalist revolutions had greatly reinforced in Europe. It seems to explain why nationalist movements had bizarrely cropped up in the civilized old world, obviously later than in the barbarous new. Read as late awakening, even if an awakening stimulated from afar, it opened an immense antiquity behind the epochal sleep. In the second place, the trope provided a crucial metaphorical link between the new European nationalisms and language. As observed earlier, the major states of 19th century Europe were vast polyglot polities, of which the boundaries almost never coincided with language communities. Most of their literate members had inherited from medieval times the habit of thinking of certain languages, if no longer Latin, then French, English, Spanish, or German, as languages of civilization. Rich 18th century Dutch burghers were proud to speak only French at home. German was the language of cultivation in much of the Western Tsarist Empire, no less than Czech Bohemia. Until late in the 18th century, no one thought of these languages as belonging to any territorially defined group. But soon thereafter, for reasons sketched out in Chapter 3, uncivilized vernaculars began to function politically in the same way as the Atlantic Ocean had earlier done, that is, to separate subjected national communities off from ancient dynastic realms. And since in the vanguard of most European popular nationalist movements were literate people often unaccustomed to using these vernaculars, this anomaly needed explanation. None seemed better than sleep, for it permitted those intelligentsias and bourgeoisies who were becoming conscious of themselves as Czechs, Hungarians, or Finns to figure their study of Czech, Magyar, or Finnish languages, folklores, and musics as rediscovering something deep down always known. Furthermore, once one starts thinking about nationality in terms of continuity, few things seem as historically deep-rooted as languages, for which no dated origins can ever be given. Now the phrase of interest here is nationalisms and language, which marks the point of intersection of theorists, poets, and philosophers. Note that the word and anti are derived from the same root. The latter, meaning opposite, rival, against, and facing, whereas the former bears the meaning of a conjunction, a joining together of two as they are placed alongside each other, much like the words metta and sandhya, the twilight. Now these words derive from a root bearing the locative sense of face, forehead, and front, thus at the fore, in front, and towards the face, which is itself derived from a root bearing the sense of on, onto, up to, over, and along. So when we read of conjunctions, we mustn't assume the identity of the two to have become one, nor that there was ever a difference to start off with. For example, the theological Weilfing is composed of verb roots. So to say the theological Weilfing and his verb roots is merely to sense a presence and vicinity, captured in the Sanskrit word anti, near, before, and in the presence or vicinity. So to speak of mnemosyny and forgetting, or philosophy and poetry, or nationalisms and language, is merely to indicate a dependency, a presence, or a vicinity. The word depend derives from two roots, the first bearing the sense to twist, weave, and stretch, giving us our words spin, spider, and panic, and our familiar root to put and to place, thus the Latin word pendere, to suspend and hang. We also derive the words ponder, as in to weigh and consider, and the word append. It's no accident that the conjunction and can be described as an appending of one thing to another. Having metaphysics appended to the physics is clearly more than just a coincidence. Now, determining which of the elements conjoined bears the predominant sense requires us to gather and collect the elements and speak of them precisely. That is to generate a logos, as we stand at the fore in the presence or vicinity of the divine. Thus we can say the word and, bearing the same sense as our root per, takes our imagination to the peak of the syllable mound. It is here that the sense of anti becomes predominant, and we must suspend the options and ponder upon which of the two bear the true essence. Philosophy and poetry, nationalism and language. Take for example the phrase memory and forgetting. We know that we remember and forget, but this knowing is due solely to memory, not forgetting. If we were to be in a perpetual state of forgetting, we would neither have memory nor remembrance. In fact, we would not have the words to remember memory or forgetting. But it is in memory that we can both remember and forget. The word forget comes from a root bearing the sense to find, hold, take, seize, and grab, giving us the words apprehend, comprehend, comprise, surprise, the word get, and the word beget. And if we add to this root our familiar root bearing the sense before, in front, and first, we get the word forget, meaning to give up and to lose hold of. And so here memory of the verb roots bears the aboriginal essence of forgetting, the act of giving up and losing hold of, an act of ultimate surrender, as when the gods forgive the sins of brutes and beasts. It is memory and forgetting, both sisters, that establish continuity, and the potential to remember discontinuities. It isn't surprising that mnemosyne is known as the mother of language. And Anderson, in his imagination, would like nationalism to rediscover something deep down always known, and for which no dated origins can ever be given. If forgetting were to be given a mind-independent existence, thus bearing the antithetical sense, following Berkeley, its esse would be percipi, precisely because its deception would be remembered against what is being perceived. And it is perhaps this sense that explains why the word sin comes from the same root as the words exist and essence. This sentiment is captured by Heidegger when discussing the anti-philosophers, their supposed leader being Nietzsche, wherein he writes, "Nevertheless, as a mere counter-movement, Nietzsche necessarily remains as everything anti held fast in the essence of that over which it moves." And here we can say, that is language, and it is speech. For us here, the essences are the verb roots of language, over against which the spoken words are moving. No amount of twisting, weaving, stretching, or spinning is going to take speech away from its eternal dependency upon the roots which it relies upon for its own existence. The same shall apply to any commentary about nationalism. Being antinatalist about language remains a self-imposed tutelage. Now, returning to the topic of nationalism and language, as Anderson puts it, he is correct in his judgment that all nationalisms depend upon language, including his own imagined communities, whether Western, liberal, democratic, or academic. In fact, it should be argued that an imagined community is only possible through language, that language is the currency of all isms, since this is the only way a mind-independent entity, such as a nation, consisting of members whose minds never become involved, might exist. When it comes to the word nationalism, its root bears the sense to produce, beget, and to birth, which we had seen a few lectures ago, and it gives us our words native, generate, gene, germ, genesis, king, renaissance, and gentile. So in one respect, it could be argued that nationalism necessarily bears the semantics of growth, reproduction, continuity, and of genesis, germinating both kings and gentiles from an aboriginal essence. It's no surprise that we get the metaphor of nationalism as language in the minds of nationalists. In fact, to expect otherwise would be to betray the aboriginal essence of the word itself, since beget and forget derive from the same root bearing the sense to seize, hold, and grab. Nations, like memories, are conceived, so that they may continuously beget, while those who forget this fact risk expending energy against a deceptive phantom. Even the anti-philosopher, or perhaps more appropriately the philologer, Nietzsche, saw language as the origin of all weavings we do in speech, writing originally, as we have seen, it is language which works on building the edifice of concepts. Later, it is science. Now, whether this is a mathematical science, a physical, biological, or social science, the concepts that distinguish each of these sciences are entirely dependent upon the language with which they are being woven. And this fact has been picked up on by those who shriek at the thoughts of nationalism. In fact, the possessors of red felts today are always on guard to pen a critique of aboriginal essences, claiming they possess no ground nor dated origins. And since in our study of language, we are in fact returning to these essences and naming them verb roots, roots that uphold all possible meanings, we remain forever sinners in their dreams. The origins of language is what the modern historian and journalist fears most. Not only because it is the tool of her trade, but because it is employed surreptitiously to make critique of all pills which seek to control the birth of her capricious speech. Indeed, it's the comfort that comes from using language without consequence that affords her sadistic undertones of power and abuse. But like Max, she has not yet encountered the theological wild things and their verb roots, which devour all birth speech with its Sprachmalerei. Let's summarize some of these elementary ideas about the political imagination with the help of Walter Benjamin, who once wrote, The German language, for example, is by no means the expression of everything that we could, theoretically, express through it, but is the direct expression of that which communicates itself in it. This itself is a mental entity. It's worth pondering over this initial framing of what appears to be a matter of fact. Benjamin makes here the correct observation that the system of sounds, that is, the vowels and consonants woven by an assortment of rules, and which we call speech, can take the name of the German language. But we also know there exist many other sound systems, the English language, the Sanskrit language, for instance. But Benjamin would like for us to consider that since a system of sounds is not common to all speakers, then we might appeal to something which gets conveyed through these sound systems, a direct expression which he calls the mental entity. He writes, "It is therefore obvious at once that the mental entity that communicates itself in language is not language itself, but something to be distinguished from it." Again, we're being asked here to conceptualize a universe where speech as systems of sounds and mental entities coexist, the latter being an essence which gets conveyed through the sounds and might be specific to an individual, or it might even be specific to a group, such as the Germans or the English, national characteristics which Mueller brought up in an earlier lecture. Still others will propose that these two need not always be separate entities. The view that the mental essence of a thing consists precisely in its language, the view taken as a hypothesis, is the great abyss into which all linguistic theory threatens to fall. And to survive suspended precisely over this abyss is its task. Here Benjamin puts forward a view for linguistic theory to take upon itself as its principal task, that the mental essence consists precisely in its language. And it is no coincidence here that he believes that this original distinction marks the original sin, the fall of man, writing in a footnote, or is it, rather, the temptation to place at the outset a hypothesis that constitutes an abyss for all philosophizing? Now, this temptation to begin linguistic science with the distinction between language and the mind, and then attempting to reconcile this self-imposed distinction, has also been noted by Berkeley, who famously stated, "Upon the whole, I am inclined to think that the far greater part, if not all, of those difficulties which have hitherto amused philosophers and blocked up the way to knowledge are entirely owing to ourselves, that we have first raised a dust and then complain we cannot see." Much like how we distinguish philosophers from sophists, by carving out distinctions we sin, for which we are truly guilty, and then proclaim we are blind too due to our mortality. But this transgression is crucial, for it generates the coveted omphalos wherein our oracles, our sophists, commune with Sophia, suspended over the generative cleft. We were reminded of the importance of transgression in our first lecture by Rod Barnett, writing, "The sacred grove is therefore a threshold space, a portal to the domain of disorder, and requires disturbance in order to remain emergent and transformative. Sacrifice should be understood as an act of transgression and as an act of atonement and goodwill." So when Benjamin speaks of the temptation to place at the outset a hypothesis which leads to the creation of an abyss, we can be assured that his commentary here is in the spirit of a necessity to carve out the sacrificial pit and light the fire, since temptation itself will raise the temperature, a motif we'll return to later. In Sanskrit, the cleft that is formed is known as the dhuni, a word derived from a root bearing the sense to make noise, and thus the Sanskrit word dvani, a sound, echo, noise, voice, tone, tune, thunder, a word, an allusion, and a hint. And thus the dhuni marks the site from which our oracular songs emanate. The cleft too bears the imagery of the vessel of the poet, the yoni, and the site above which the depths of being are pondered. As we saw Piaget also putting it, it's the deepest part of our being from which the idea, that is the logos, emerges. From this fertile and mysterious region, which man on his own never reaches, it is this vital source from which emanations well up only under the sublime influence. Now, the word suspend is derived by adding a root up. And to tie some semantic threads here, note that Athena, the mind of a god, goddess of neuroscience, is derived from two roots sharing the same senses with the word ponder. Now, returning to Benjamin, surviving suspended over the oracular cleft is precisely the task of linguistic science. So when we defined language as the musical and metrical praises invoking mnemosyne, we too reserve this task, having distinguished musical from metrical, and then both from mnemosyne. Now, this distinction between a mental entity and the linguistic entity in which it communicates is the first stage of any study of linguistic theory. And this distinction seems so unquestionable that it is rather the frequently asserted identity between mental and linguistic being that constitutes a deep and incomprehensible paradox, the expression of which is found in the ambiguity of the word logos. For Benjamin here, the paradox consists in precisely the task wherein the antithesis between mental and linguistic is posited as the hypothesis, and the resultant journey to reunite the original unity as identity. The word paradox consists of two roots. The first bears the sense to take and perceive, from which we derive the words decorate, dignity, that is to solemnly elevate, dexterous, meaning skillful, agile, proper, fit, and adept, that is an epithet of our fremdling, our adia, and in Greek we have doxa, meaning opinion and expectation, honor and glory. Now adding to this word our root per, from which we derive the words praise and prize, we have paradox, that is something beyond estimation, the utmost glory, strange and incredible. Note here that the sense of the root for the words and anti is shared by our root for the words praise and prize, invoking for us the imagery of the stranger atop the peak of the syllable mound, suspending judgment and pouring forth the solution, both potion and poison. Nevertheless, this paradox has a place, as a solution, at the center of linguistic theory, but remains a paradox and insoluble, if placed at the beginning. Now we can't delve into the details of Benjamin's own weaving of a solution to this paradox, though we can say that whatever solution he himself does end up pouring as libation, it originated at the beginning, upon the filthy feet being dipped into the holy springs, waters healing his sore wounds atop the peak of Olympus, whereupon the feet of Mnemosyne's daughters dance to his musical and metrical praises. Paradox and solution, filthy and pure, fallen and saved, death and life, are antinomies we expect from our singing bards. Behold, for I was captured in lawlessness, and a sinner when my mother conceived me. What emanated and precipitated from the mother was a sin, but it was this sin that revealed the paradox, the primal praiseworthy act of transgression, of ritual sacrifice. The original sin was reciting and revealing the secret. Brahma pouring from his nectarine mouth, Om Matato Brahma Jijnyasa. Now this text which pours from Brahma Shtimma requires a rigorous technique to receive, conceive, and to perceive, since we don't want the muses to deceive us as we participate in his seminar, and with its dream-inducing capacity of hypnosis as it gushes forth into our red earthen vessels. For it is the cosmic eulogy that leaves our devoted thoughts thinking back, utterly speechless. The word dream is a state of frenzy or ecstasy, a state of desires and wishes, and is derived from a root bearing the sense to deceive and mislead, giving us the Sanskrit root druh, meaning to hurt, injure, harm, and offend. Today, we locate the name dreams to that which happens during sleep, a word derived from a root bearing the sense to weaken, release, to be lazy, or to be slow. But there is not a beast among us that is not dreaming whilst awake, whether for goods, possessions, or unmet expectations. So we should cut ourselves some slack, even when awake, remembering not to get lost and forgotten in its hypnotic trances, a word derived from the Greek word hypnos, meaning sleep and slumber, and is derived from a root bearing the sense to sleep and lull. A similar sense we saw giving us the name Lemosini. We also derive our Sanskrit root swap, to fall asleep, lie down, and to die, and the Latin word supor, meaning deep sleep or the sleep of death. Thus we find with these roots the imagery necessary to direct our attention to a potential cause of deception, namely being lethargic and slacking off, senses that relate to lemosini. We now have a richer sense of the trope Anderson invoked when discussing nations awakening from sleep. But this can all be ameliorated with the help of rules and directions which make upright and rigorous our postures. This is evident from the fact that our root for the word home is itself derived from a root bearing the sense to sire, beget, and bring forth, from which we derive our words text, context, pretext, textile, and texture. Now the meaning of text overlaps with the sense to weave, knit, and plait, thus words like context and textile denoting something begotten from weaving. In this case, the seminar, begotten from the mouth of the grandsire himself. We also derive the Greek word techne from this root, meaning craft, skill, trade, and art, cunning, and wile. And the Sanskrit root thaksh, meaning to cut, chisel, chop, to fashion, form, and make, to create, and to invent. Interestingly, we derive as an extension from this root another bearing the sense to set in motion, to move, to lie down, to settle, home, family, love, and beloved, giving us our Latin word civis, meaning native or townsman, giving us our English words city and civilian, and hiu, meaning household, domesticated, servant, retainer, and rascal. Furthermore, in Latin we derive the word sino, meaning to let, permit, allow, to suffer, put down, and to lay, to which if we add our familiar root upo, we get the Latin word pono, to place, set up, ordain, appoint, and surrender, and thus the word posture, to hold a situation or condition. The phrase city of speech is well known in Platonic circles, and we can now say definitively that such speech is that which is woven at home, at the ritual site, in the red earthen vessel. Now to fashion a text that is rigorous is certainly in line with our familiar imagery of the devoted thought thinking back to what is to be thought, since the word rigorous is derived as an extension of our familiar root meaning to straighten, to right oneself, and to justify, which gave us our words raj, source, surge, and upright. In the Latin, we derive the word rigeo, meaning to stiffen and to stand upright, from which we get our English word rigid, meaning stern, strict, severe, and hard, and the adjective rigorous, meaning accurate, precise, and intense. So perhaps we can say for certain, in keeping with the spirit of Walt, that for a space to be named America, North or South, it better be a home that is rigorous enough to receive the bards, the sophists, and the anti-philosophers who visit from the boundaries or ends of textures, as preserved in the Sanskrit word anta, meaning limit, boundary, border, edge, the end of a texture, or the hem of a textile. And this root is derived from our root which gave us the words and, anti, and end. Now if we add to this root our root vid, we get our word Vedanta, which I have translated here as being in the presence or vicinity of the gods, the shining ones, the devas. Now there is no doubt that Vedanta marks the peak of Olympus, the site where, to paraphrase Edward Casey, space gets to place in a fairly short stretch of time. And this place becomes home, the red earthen vessel of the poets. That site where ending philosophy befits an ineffable act of absolute surrender, of sacrifice, whereupon the muses dance to the invocations of the strangers.
And as our stranger Bhadarayana sings it, O Matato Brahmajitnyasa.
Now these songs, in Greek called Odi, meaning speech, sound, oracle, song, and ode, are poured forth at the peak by the Eidos, singers, minstrels, bards, and enchanters. words derived from the Greek verb eidol, to sing, chant, praise, hoot, howl, croak, and celebrate. Itself derived from a root bearing the sense to speak, sing, chant, praise, and make noise. We derive the Sanskrit root vad, to speak, praise, chant, and sing, and thus the word vadya, meaning a speech, a statement, or instrumental music. This was the same root we saw that gave us the name of our stranger, Hesiod, he who emits the voice of the gods by singing of the divine muses first and last. What is significant for us here is the fact that the word comedy contains the root of our bard Hesiod, itself composed of two roots, the other bearing the sense to wish and to desire, giving us the words charity, meaning regard, esteem, affection, and love, and whore, that is someone who is sexually promiscuous. In Sanskrit, we get the word kama, meaning wish, desire, a longing, sensual and sexual pleasure, and enjoyment. And in Greek, the word komos, meaning a festival, a procession, to revel, and a carousel. Now, comedy is believed to have gradually developed out of the cults of Dionysus, god of plants and wine, who was resurrected by Zeus, and thus named god of death and resurrection. Much of his imagery pertains to reproduction, transition, and seasonal festivities. His companions were the satyrs, from which we derive our contemporary word satire, meaning ridiculing as an intended means of provoking or preventing change. Again, transitional or twilight imagery. The word satyr derives from the Greek satyros, meaning lewdness, fondness for unrestrained revelry and celebration, and is composed of two roots. The first, our familiar root, sa, meaning to plant, impress, and insert, from which we derive our words sow, seed, season, seasoning, semen, and seminar. And the second root bears the sense to hunt, a wild animal, and a beast, from which we derive our words feral, meaning wild, savage, cruel, and untamed, fierce, exceedingly violent, severe, ferocious, cruel, and savage, or in the Greek, thyr, a wild beast or a beast of prey. Thus the satyrs, with their satirical takes, partake in the imagery of a divine comedy, which is ultimately an ode to the divine whores, a tale of receiving Brahma's charitable seminar within their omphalos, the fierce and sharp-eared one suspended over the shtimma, Zuhuran. But comedy is not the only Dionysian-inspired odi. In keeping with the imagery of his goat-horned companions, tragedy denotes goat songs, or songs of characters wearing goat skins, imitating the satyrs. The word tragedy derives from the Greek word tragos, meaning a goat, or the age when the change of voice and other signs of puberty appear, from the Greek word trago, meaning to gnaw, nibble, munch, and swallow, thus also giving us the word tragikos, goatly, stately, majestic, and solemn, and the word tragic, causing sadness. These words derive from a root bearing the sense to rub, turn, drill, and pierce. We also get from this root our English words turn, thread, throw, thresh, that is to beat soundly, attrition, meaning grinding down or wearing away by friction, and contrite, meaning sincerely penitent or feeling regret or sorrow. We also get the word trauma, being wounded or being hurt. Now, we had stated earlier that the death of Lincoln, or more precisely, the commencement of his supor, was tragic, a captain fallen cold and dead upon his own vessel. But the way the historians tell it, in 1865, Lincoln was attending a comedy, a play titled Our American Cousin at Ford's Theater. In fact, comedy is all about timing, and our captain's death was the punchline. Now, whether this is mere coincidence or an orchestrated demonstration, we leave to the creative imagination. If reality is to be read as a text, then comedy and tragedy certainly form an important pairing. Aristotle defined comedy as a mimesis or imitation of inferior people. people who are worthless, sorry, indifferent, poor, and bad. Not, however, that it has to do with the whole range of wickedness, but with that which is funny, or laughable, an aspect of ugliness. Harsh words for the lovers of comedy, but not without reason. If the faculty of imitation is the imagination, and its output is imagery, then we can perhaps take seriously the claim that invoking in our mimesis any aspect of wickedness or malevolence might prevent us from reaching our own ends, risking entrapment in desires and wishes, a forgetfulness which lulls one into a dream. So to antagonize comedy, Aristotle defines tragedy as a mimesis of praxis, an action arising from choice and directed towards a goal. That is, it is morally serious and purposeful, having magnitude and bringing about through the events enacted in the play the purification of those destructive or painful acts. Meaning that the imagery of a tragedy invokes in the imagination aspects of virtue and benevolence, antithetical to the wickedness and malevolence within comedy, which, as we read, is achieved through a praxis or conduct that is serious, purposeful, and having depth in meaning. In other words, is moral. Later we'll develop the idea of mimesis in its relation to praxis, and judge how Aristotle's master, Plato, liberally employs it within his own critique of poets. Specifically, we'll look at how Plato's own critique of the poets appeals to moral purpose and seriousness through dialectical reasoning, and this becomes his primary apology to exclude poets from his divine city of speech, the Republic. Tradition has it that Plato, former playwright, was masterful in his ability to generate tragedies and poems, but opted to burn his texts upon meeting his director, Socrates. The transcendental story here being that Plato burnt his home, the red earthen vessel, and became well-baked with the fire of rigor and technique to receive and partake in the lucrative mysteries of applause. The word lucrative, meaning profitable or a target worth hunting down, derives from a root bearing the sense to seize, gain, benefit, and to prize. Imagery reminiscent of our satirists. The speaking of republicans in texts, the sophisticated sophists sure do like to remind the Platonists that Lincoln, former captain of America, died laughing. And this fact brings us to the crux of the dialectic between comedy and tragedy, between malevolence and benevolence, wickedness and virtue. The word dialectic refers to the art of argumentation, enacted through the exchange of questions and answers. But more generally, the word dialectic is employed in theoretical circles to denote the vicious battle between warbands, which either reconcile into a more coherent whole or succumb to the fates of misfortune, a dynamic succinctly captured by Marx in his introductory remarks of the Communist Manifesto. Freeman and slave, patrician and plebeian, lord and serf, guildmaster and journeyman, in a word, oppressor and oppressed, to which I'd like to add here, teachers and disciples, stood in constant opposition to one another, carried on in an uninterrupted, now hidden, now open, fight. A fight that each time ended either in a revolutionary reconstitution of society at large, or in the common ruin of the contending classes. Now, we're not yet capable with our verb roots to partake in the depths of the conceptual space that makes up this dialectic, but at the request of a colleague, I'll briefly demonstrate how roots are an invaluable means for methodically taming the imagery of this divine drama and informing us about its theoretical and neurological underpinnings. For its esse is indeed percipi. Marx is certainly not the only thinker in the story of conceptual analysis to stumble upon this peculiar semantic opposition. Aristotle, in discussing poetics, once stated, "Once comedy and tragedy had been brought to light, the people who were pressing toward each of the two types of composition, that is, serious and mean, became, according to the inherent nature of each, makers of comedy instead of iambics, and of tragedy instead of epics, because these two forms were grander and more admirable than the others." In fact, in Aristotle, we see an appeal to an inherent nature, either of the forms or of its makers, that founds the emergence of a preference towards these two poles. This inherent nature sounds much like that of the distinction spoken so highly of by Walter Benjamin, and it too constitutes a deep and incomprehensible paradox, the expression of which is found in the ambiguity of the word logos. It comes to no surprise, then, that the dialectic, a word derived from the word logos, would bring to completion, via the prefix dia, its inherent paradox in the form of comedy and tragedy in the dramatic arts, or more generally, the paradox between reconstitution and ruin. The point here being that we are not speaking of any particular distinction or paradox, but of the very fact of it being operative in our thoughts. Just as what was said now, not something particular, but the mere fact of it. The word but here is a functional word marking a point of conjunction. Now, since the verb root for the word junction is the same as that of join, yoke, and zugma, we know its function to be bringing together opposites, not this but that. Conjunction, junction, what's your function? I'm gonna get you there if you're very careful. In other words, exhausting the particularities of any given antagonism, say between oppressor and oppressed, is not going to suddenly reveal to us why such antagonisms persist even at all. We've already heard from Benjamin and Barnett that this distinction is precisely the task of all analytic strivings, suspended above the portal of chaos, keeping all this emergent and dynamic. But Marx here reminds us that experiments in laboratories can be deadly. The risk for reconstitution inherently bears that of ruin, a site ripe for paradoxical ideas such as benevolence and malevolence. Now, Dante is certainly familiar with this dramatic paradox. In medieval poetics, tragedy was considered a higher genre than comedy, and thus Dante, in naming his work the Comedy, juxtaposed his own work to Virgil's Aeneid, a tragedy. A gesture of supreme humility and modesty, becoming of the higher slaves, and of the categorically oppressed disciples. You see, bards like Dante, anointed with the holy salve, don't hide away from terrifying words when they set sail upon the creative seas, but simply pay attention to verbs and their imagery. In this manner, they reach the crux of the dialectic. The word crux is derived from our familiar root bearing the sense to cut, swing, jump, move, bend, and curve, and refers to a critical transitional moment or a central or turning point, but also to torture and misery, and a summit, hill, or heap. The imagery here is explicit, referring to the peak of the syllable mound where the voice is the loudest and most intense. The critical site where the laments and wails of criminals and crucified saints are heard. The latter here fit for effortlessly battling malevolence and transforming the excruciating pains into sacrificial poetry. The cosmic eulogies devoted to the highest good, tortured with the gift of insight, riddles, and prophecy, atoning the crises of all transgressions through their works of tragedy. It is for these reasons that our word crux also gives us the word crucible, a ceramic vessel used in smelting, thus subject to extremely high temperatures, thus used poetically to denote a severe test or trial or an extremely challenging experience of experts. So we're not out of line to declare that the crucible is our poet's vessel. And this poet is none other than our anointed bard, baptized and christened with ghee, a logos enriched with the nectar of immortality, bearing the cross that helps all wandering caravans of strangers return home from across the shores. Perhaps we can envision here a cross formed upon the mast of their vessels out at sea, seeking to capture the cosmic breaths when composing the divine poetry, observing always the sinful secret that precipitated from the mouth, from the stimma of Brahma. It's true that X marks the spot for the greatest of all pleasures and treasures, the goals of all forms of praxis, a word whose root bears the sense to go over or to go across. But we are reminded here too of the sacrifice, where the anointed bard called out,
Eli Eli Lama Sabachthani.
My God, why have you forsaken me? Now I've chosen this verse from the Psalms for two reasons. First, the word used by the bards to call upon a god is Eli, and derives from a Proto-Semitic preposition bearing the sense to, towards, till, until, near, nigh, into, at, and by, all of which we'll become familiar with as we read through Mueller. But for now, I'd like for you to map the imagery of all of these functional words to the peak of the mound, at the site of the cross. We also derive the Hebrew verb, il, meaning to wail, lament, and cry, from this root. Acts denoting the loudness of the vowel over all other consonants. It's no coincidence that the noun, verb, and preposition all coincide with the mapping at the peak. The root for Eli is itself an extension of another bearing the sense of strength and power and deity, the shining or glowing one, from which we derive the Hebrew demonstrative pronoun El, meaning these and those, and the noun El, meaning a deity and strength. Again, preserving the imagery of the loudness with which the injunctions are spoken from the wilderness against malevolence. Now, to capture the fullness of this imagery, the high priest utter the plural, Elohim, as in the tragedy of Genesis. Barashit bara Elohim. In the beginning, the gods lopped the trees for catharsis. For how else do these sophisticated gods, Gentiles, bards, pagans, sorcerers, heroes, Olympians, artisans, strangers, and ascetics create at the fore, at the shtimma of being? Now, keeping these poetics in mind, the second reason for invoking the Psalms at this crossroad is to share the sense of complete agony which characterizes the crucible, captured succinctly by the famous warrior Slavoj Žižek, reciting, I take seriously these words Christ says at the end, Eli Eli Lama Sabachthani. It's something really tremendous that happens. J.K. Chesterton, whom I admire, puts it in a wonderful way. Only in Christianity does God himself, for a moment, become atheist. Specifically, Žižek refers here to Chesterton's book, Orthodoxy, published in 1908, wherein he writes, In this indeed I approach a matter more dark and awful than it is easy to discuss, and I apologize in advance if any of my phrases fall wrong or seem irreverent, touching a matter which the greatest saints and thinkers have justly feared to approach. But in that terrific tale of the Passion, there is a distinct emotional suggestion that the author of all things, in some unthinkable way, went not only through agony, but through doubt. He passed in some superhuman manner through our human horror of pessimism. When the world shook and the sun was wiped out of heaven, it was not at the crucifixion, but at the cry from the cross. The cry which confessed that God was forsaken of God. Nay, the matter grows too difficult for human speech. But let the atheists themselves choose a God. They will find only one divinity whoever uttered their isolation, only one religion in which God seemed for an instant to be an atheist. It would appear then that the process of individuation, of turning to complete isolation from the collective, which we call the sacrifice of the gods, invokes a polytheism that strikes horror at the very heart of a monotheistic imagination, a riddle more dark and awful than it is easy to discuss. But here we see something interesting. The monotheist instead appeals to atheism to avoid the multiplicity of gods, rather than assert the Olympians atop the peak. Put in other terms, if they can't have one, then they'll have none. Strange indeed that the burden of polytheism remains for them more unbearable than the cross itself. But attending to the nay is indeed a proper gesture. Atheism, agnosticism, a-religious, anatman, all in short, avoidance. For the void is the shtimma of being, and legends persist that not everyone achieves isolation, the cave, and church. Nor are they disciplined for religion, capable of managing the collective. Orthodoxy is only self-evident to those initiated. To this effect, I quote here again the insight of Belbo the Stoic. Those who reviewed carefully and went over and over again all that pertained to the rituals of the gods were called religious, from religare. The word religare is derived from a root for the word logos by an addition of the root for the vratyas, the ascetics, and comes from the Latin word religo, meaning to gather, collect again, and to recover, to travel, traverse, or sail over or through again. A recursive gesture fitting of the claim that God was forsaken of God. But whereas this is viewed as a moment of despair to monotheists, the death of ego and a return back, religion itself, to the totality of the sacrifice of the gods, is plenty of food for thought. Zizek too hints upon this plurality and multiplicity which underlies all forms of individuation. Writing, and I think this is my reading, that the moment of the death of God, when you are totally abandoned and you only have your collectivity called the Holy Spirit, is the authentic moment of freedom. Now there's much more to be said here, but what I hope to have demonstrated here is the indispensability of etymology in taming the imagery of the most abstract, obtuse, and difficult to navigate waters in the study of the legends of being. But it's not only in the study of semantics that an acquaintance with etymology is necessary to tame ideas both in theory and orthodoxy. Recall Heidegger proclaiming, "We forsake up the stimme of being, zuhuren." The cross clearly marks the stimme of being, the swara properly tuned, and the crucible properly heated, to procure for all understandings, obeisances, and perceptions, the soma from the midspace, evidently before our eyes. And it is for this reason that we derive the word aesthetic from the same root as the word huron. Aesthetics, a word for which I've taken the liberty to define here, is the art of making sense, or of making idols, or the art of baking the red earthen vessel. The word derives from the Greek word aisthonomai, to perceive, apprehend, notice, and understand, which is certainly preserving the imagery of our poet's vessel, the crucible. So to discover that the Sanskrit root ush, giving us the name of our ruddy red twilight, ushas, we aren't surprised to find the sense of burning, consuming, punishing, and injuring being simultaneously conjured up with the twilight. And for purely aesthetic reasons, we find that our crucible and vessel converge at sandhya, the twilight, Krishna, the dusk, and usra, the dawn. The topic of aesthetics is immense, since the theme of the meaning of life is simultaneously one of making sense. Now there are two ways to go about a discussion on aesthetics. The first is secular, as in how Camilla Peglia discusses her aesthetic choice of the title for her book, Break, Blow, Burn, writing, "My title comes from a poem in this book, John Donne's Holy Sonnet 14. That I may rise and stand, overthrow me, and bend your force to break, blow, burn, and make me new." Donne is appealing to God to overwhelm him and compel his redemption from sin. My secular but semi-mystical view of art is that it taps primal energies, breaks down barriers, and imperiously remakes our settled way of seeing. Animated by the breath force, the original meaning of spirit and inspiration, poetry brings exhilarating spiritual renewal. Now the acts of bending, breaking, curving, cutting, swinging, and burning are all reminiscent of the divine artisans partaking in the remaking of the home, and redeeming once again the sinners, now reborn as poets tapping into the primal energies. Note the overlap here of the cathartic imagery in our roots for the words poetry, citta, technique, and logos. I say once again here to invoke the word religion, as the religious aesthetic is supposedly the non-secular counterpart for our human condition. But I have yet to come across a coherent discussion of aesthetics that does not invoke the gods, for the pleasure of the creative imagination necessitates the ruddy one becoming manifest with the names of the cow. Holding in mind this newfound imagery,
we can return to Rishi Kakshivan's verse to Ushas, singing Krishna Duttastatariya Vihayash Chikatsanti Manushaya Kshayaya. Up from the dark has arisen the lady of extensive power, being attentive to the human home. Like Athena had made an Eidolon in Penelope's home, in the poet's vessel, Ushas did the same for Rishi Kakshivan, anointing both with the salve worthy of divination. To mark the site of the ritual sacrifice, where the anointing reoccurs, we discover that the word site is derived from the Latin word itself from the root sino. Therefore, the home is the site, the vessel of the poet, where in prophecy, the swaras at the peak reverberates. Now, these poetics were not absent in the biblical sages. As Walter Benjamin puts it, the Bible, in regarding itself as revelation, must necessarily evolve the fundamental linguistic facts. The word Bible comes from two roots, the first bearing the sense of a well or a source, and the second, our familiar one, bearing the sense of a deity, a shining one, and strength, thus meaning a well or a source of strength or of God. Now what's interesting is that the word strength is derived from a root bearing the sense to twist and twine into a rope or a cord, also giving us the word string, which we have seen emerges in our root sense for the words create, creature, and crescent. This motif here being that woven texts claiming to arise from the crucible, the divine poet's vessel, must themselves embody the fundamental linguistic facts, the ritual of the gods. And again, this link between language and ritual is what we are interested in as we map our etymological roots. So when we read in Genesis, Barashit bara Elohim, in the beginning the gods created, the first verb of the text preserves the imagery of Brahma, the well and source of creation pouring forth Om, engaged in the act of catharsis. Another point we can note here is that the word Reshit means chief or head, indicating the peak of the syllable mound, where the strength of the sonority of the sages, the gods, or the Elohim is the greatest. Thus we can reread Barashit bara Elohim as at the peak, the poets lock the trees of the grove. Now perhaps to summarize these brief comments on aesthetics, we can hear from Wilford Cantwell Smith, who concluded his book, The Meaning and End of Religion, with the statement, God is the end of religion, also in the sense that once he appears vividly before us, in his depth and love and unrelenting truth, all else dissolves. Now this is expected, as the recurring end of religion is Vedanta, the teacher pouring and anointing his disciple's vessel, Om. These twilight aesthetics have also been scribed down in more recent memory by modernity's resident philologist and the lord of all war bands bearing the title of atheism, Friedrich Nietzsche, famous for uttering the godforsaken mantra, God is dead. This is probably not going to be a popular opinion, but under my estimation, Nietzsche was a Christian theorist, likely one traceable to a lineage of heretical caravans that roamed the deserts prior to the Council of Nicaea in 325, where Saint Nicholas is said to have become so heated that at one point he slapped the sage Arius on the face for reducing, in his mind, Christ to the status of a demigod, and thus pagan polytheism back into their pages. Now legend has it that the gods, lovers of the cryptic, gave Arius a boon to avenge for this slap. O Arius, avenger of plenty, we bless thee with victorious generations. And surely enough, a child named Nietzsche sprung forth upon the streams of history. The word Nicholas derives from our familiar root bearing the sense to conceal, hide, and to escape, from the Greek laos, meaning a people under arms and soldiers. And if we add to this root another bearing the sense to attack or start vehemently, which gives us our word Nike, meaning victory, and thus Nikolos, victory of the people. Unsurprisingly, we discover that Nicholas is the patron saint of sailors, of fishermen, and of poetic vessels out at sea. And surely enough, the poetics of Arius's boon become self-evident in the German, with the name Nietzsche, the Slavic diminutive of Nicholas, an eternally recurring reminder of the disorderly posture on the part of Nicholas in failing to uphold the disciplined etiquettes of the dialectic.
Even Chesterton felt the inadequacy of the Christian Orthodox logos. When he approached the site of the Olympians, writing, "The matter grows too difficult for human speech." And we all know that when the logos becomes weak, there is a resort to violence. Thus, to preserve these poetics, Nietzsche is often given the epithet of anti-Christian philosopher, or sometimes even the anti-philosopher. Again, anti used here in the Vedantic sense of standing within the vicinity of the devas. Which devas, one might rightfully ask? I'll let the bard speak for himself. He writes, "Already in the preface to Richard Wagner, it is asserted that art, and not morality, is the true metaphysical activity of man. Several times in the book itself, the provocative sentence recurs, that the existence of the world is justified only as an aesthetic phenomena. Indeed, the whole book acknowledges only an artist's meaning, and hidden meaning, behind all that happens. A god, if you will." Two things. First, that Nietzsche invokes the imagery of prophetic insight, the self-evident phantoms appearing in Penelope's vessel, Arumati, the devoted thoughts thinking back to what is to be thought, manifesting as well-formed ritual formulae, poured from the mouths of our strangers, gods, if you will. Second, elevating the art of articulation to the summit of Olympus, or more specifically, to the peak where the voice is the loudest and excruciating, Zuhuren, reverberates with the invocation of Richard Wagner's name, who once proclaimed, "The oldest, truest, most beautiful organ of music, the origin to which alone our music owes its being, is the human voice." Recalling that the swaras and sonority of the seers, Rishiswaram, sustains the elevation of the Elohim, the gods, Olympians, bards, pagans, artisans, strangers, and ascetics. We are pleased to discover that tones, a word derived from the Greek teno, meaning to stretch, extend, spread, exert, push to the limit, and strain, marks this sonority peak. So in equating vowels, tones, and voice, we are in no way deviating from the underlying imagery of the ritual, and it will become self-evident as we delve deeper into the techniques of aesthetics as to why tones invoke thoughts, tinged with ruddy names exerting their own in being. We shall have gained much for the science of aesthetics when we have come to realize not just through logical insight, but also with the certainty of something directly apprehended, that the continuous evolution of art is bound up with the duality of the Apolline and the Dionysiac, in much the same way as reproduction depends on there being two sexes which coexist in a state of perpetual conflict, interrupted only occasionally by periods of reconciliation, and might I add here, in keeping with the dialectic, or in their common ruin. We have borrowed these names from the Greeks who revealed the profound mysteries of their view of art to those with insight, not in concepts, admittedly, but through the penetrating vivid figures of their gods. Perhaps it is worth emphasizing here that for Nietzsche, it's not just through logical insight or conceptualization that the dialectic can be apprehended. No strings of words, phrases, or clauses can in themselves exhaust the study of aesthetics, the dialogue occurring at the peak of the mound between mother, father, and son. It must also be invoked with the articulate rational order, ritualized as ratios and rhymes, bearing the vivid figures of the oracular Adia's harmonious imagination. Put succinctly, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. Thus far, the logical insights we've been employing have derived from the method of etymology, taming vivid figures of the syllable mounds and vessels in relation to verbs. What we find in Nietzsche is a further elaboration on the dialectic between ideas and idols. As he writes, "Their two deities of art, Apollo and Dionysus, provide the starting point for our recognition that there exists in the world of the Greeks an enormous opposition, both in origin and goals, between the Apolline art of the image maker or sculptor and the imageless art of music, which is that of Dionysus." Now, before we indulge ourselves with the Apolline and Dionysiac visions, a reminder,
never take for granted any dualisms nor duels being conjured up by a given thinker. That between poet and philosopher, there is indeed an opposition, but its dialectic is not meant to prevent future duels between them. In other words, the reconstitution is never at the expense of one or the other, but always a rhythm which ensures the perpetual generation of insights about being, poets and philosophers. That is, where the task of one ends, the other begins, going and returning with goods to maintain a system of communion. Now, Nietzsche captures this sentiment a bit later when he states, "Not that it is only the pleasant and friendly images which give him his feelings of complete intelligibility. He also sees passing before him things which are grave, gloomy, sad, dark, sudden blocks, teasing of chance, anxious expectations. In short, the entire divine comedy of life, including the inferno. But not like some mere shadow play, for he too lives in these scenes and shares in the suffering." Thus, when we juxtapose two names against each other, say idols and ideas, we seek to mark an underlying dynamic, in our case here, the dynamics of our verb root, wherein both idols and ideas are working together to achieve higher peaks in the creative imagination, and never to undermine the visions being sustained by the verbs manifesting as the root itself. Our access to theological or hierarchical visions, what Iliada called hierophanies, is a privilege that has taken much time to develop. And the last thing we need now is an incomplete mimesis by ideologues possessed of a mind of scarcity, blaming theologians of one tradition for the lack of creativity in their own. Much gets said of Nietzsche's relation to asceticism, but not enough was said by Nietzsche about the relation between ascetics and artists. All our contemporary anti-ascetics have much to answer for, now that the neuroscientists of Hecateme's gymnasium have begun asking questions. One, for example, is what brand of asceticism makes your anti-ascetic warband feel qualified to bear the prefix anti before ascetics? You see, recursion is but a poetic device, an aesthetic formulated by ascetics to delight in their passion for crucibles. Arius was an ascetic, and when there's a drought, the ascetics are sure to transpire from the stimma of being. So let's take a closer look at the names of our gods, Apollo and Dionysus. Apollo is derived as an extension of our familiar root bar, meaning before, in front, first, a going or passage, as in a journey, the root of our word fremdling. Recall that our sonorant consonants, r and l, in roots are interconnected. Thus bar becomes our familiar root bal, bearing the sense to cover, to wrap, skin, hide, clothe, to fold, weave, to beat, push, and to drive, from which we derive our English words fold, pelt, pulverize, that is, render into dust, and pollen. And further, a root from which we derive the words plate and duplicitous, our strangers' simultaneously cryptic yet clear speech. Another root we derive bears the sense of a fortification, a city, or a stronghold, giving us our Sanskrit word pur, meaning a wall, castle, city, or a town, and the Greek polis, meaning a fortification or city, from which we derive our word political. Furthermore, we derive another root bearing the sense of a rock or a cliff, giving us our Sanskrit word bashi, meaning a stone or a rock, and the Greek word pella, meaning a wooden bowl, a milk pail, a drinking cup, or stone, from which we get the Greek word apella, meaning a fence, wall, and enclosure of stones, and a meeting place. Thus, from this imagery, we derive our name Apollo, our Megistos Kauros, our magnificent creation, our praiseworthy Mahavira of the Pravargya, our glowing ascetic's vessel, well-baked, hearing the political imagination, a divine shelter for generations of strangers to come. As Nietzsche puts it, the Greeks also expressed the joyous necessity of dream experience in their Apollo.
As a god of all image-making energies, Apollo is also the god of prophecy. According to the etymological root of his name, he is the luminous one, Dirshinende, the god of light. As such, he also governs the lovely semblance, shine, produced by the inner world of fantasy. We see that Nietzsche employs etymology to preserve the imagery of Apollo's relation to prophecy and fantasy, words that we saw coming from a root bearing the sense to shine, glow, to be bright, and to speak, using the German words shine and scheinende. Now, it's important to note here that Nietzsche is not actually preserving the etymology of the name Apollo directly, but instead relies upon the imagery associated with the hot and glowing home to invoke the root bearing the sense to clarify, to order, and to arrange, which gives us the German shine, and our English words shine and shimmer. We've already seen the word shine appear in relation to a root that gave us our words prophecy and fantasy, words that bear simultaneously the visual and the auditory. Now, this is important because although Apollo's name is being invoked here by Nietzsche in relation to the imagery and the visual, it is by no stretch of the imagination limited to the visual. This is evidently clear from the root of the word clear itself, derived from our familiar root bearing the sense to be obligated, to owe, and to be guilty. From it we derive our Old Norse word skald, our poet, and another root bearing the sense to call, cry, summon, and to invoke, thus giving our English words low, as in cows mooing, counsel, class, and proclaim, exclaim, reclaim, and acclaim. In Sanskrit, the root grand, meaning to sound, make noise, to neigh, roar, cry, and lament. In Greek, kaleo, meaning to call, summon, to invoke. And in Latin, clarus, meaning bright, loud, distinct, audible, illustrious, celebrated, and glorious, thus from which we derive our words clear and clarify. Again, we find imagery denoting the loudness of the peak of the syllable mound, a midspace where the two are intertwined, simultaneously idol and idea, visual and auditory. We encountered this duplicitous phenomena with our root for the word prophecy, and can safely proclaim that our root bar in prophecy is a reminder of Apollo, god of the sophisticated, prophets, artists, and oracles, the sharp-eared ones of the first class, the Elohim. Now, having invoked the skald in relation to the crucible, our poet's vessel, perhaps we can restate what we said earlier, Bereshit bara Elohim. At the peak, Reshet meaning chief and head, bara meaning to lop and to cut. Thus, at the peak, the artists lopped the trees, as in catharsis, an act of pruning, clearing, or shearing the trees. Now, this purification as cleansing is a well-founded association in poetics, yet few appreciate the role of speaking clearly and concisely in the cathartic process. As Nietzsche writes, the higher truth, the perfection of these dream states, in contrast to the only partially intelligible reality of the daylight world, together with the profound consciousness of the helping and healing powers of nature in sleep and dream, is simultaneously the symbolic analog of the ability to prophesy, and indeed of all the arts through which life is made possible and worth living. Again, the imagery of healing and life being made possible and worth living again is intimately linked to the perfection of the dream states. And for Nietzsche, this manifests in the deed of articulation. More generally, a perfected deed, to invoke prophetic imagery through speech itself for the atonement of all sacrificial transgressions. Now, this description is entirely in line with what we heard from Homer, with Athena creating an idol in Penelope's dream while she slept, providing her with the higher truth that stabilized her fears and concerns. Her brother Apollo, however, is known to prophesy through oracles. Now, there's much to be said about dreams, prophecy, Apollo, and Athena, but for now it's sufficient to say that they both fancy drink and song.
The name Dionysus, on the other hand, is thought to derive from two roots. The first is our familiar root Diu, to shine, glow, and be bright, giving us words like deity, divine, journey, and in Sanskrit our root Div and Jyot. And in Greek the word Zeus, from which we derive our genitive Dios, meaning belonging to or of Zeus. Again, the imagery of sophisticated prophetic speech, clear, clever, and concise, appears too with the invocation of the name of Dionysus. The second root bears the sense to marry and wed, the word wed itself from a root bearing the sense to bind and lead, from which we derive our words nuptials, pertaining to marriage or weddings. The Greek word nymphi, meaning bride and young wife, the goddess of springs, from which we derive our word nymph, a young girl, virgin, or lass. In Sanskrit, the word snusha, meaning daughter-in-law, and the Greek nios, a bride, wife, or daughter-in-law, and nisos, meaning a son. So if we put together the two roots, we get the word Dionysus, meaning a son of God. We can view this second root as an extension of another, bearing the sense to swim, float, flow, and drip, giving us our words nurse, nutrient, and nourish, the Greek word neo, meaning to swim and float, and the Sanskrit root sna, meaning to bathe and wash, wherefore the word snata, meaning bathed, washed, cleansed, and purified and versed in. Now this overlap of flowing imagery with rites of passage, specifically those pertaining to puberty and marriage, is quite familiar, as in our contemporary expression, a bridal shower. But we also find our word snataka, an initiated one, or a graduate, bachelor, and even a beggar of alms. Again, preserving rites of passage imagery, though not necessarily localized to puberty. Note here that our Greek word neo is also derived from our familiar root bearing the sense to spin and sew, thus our Greek word nous. The imagery here reinforces the vision of twining streams pouring forth from the spring, intermingling as it twists and turns, dripping and flowing from the mouth of Brahma. O matato Brahma jitnyasa. These twists and turns of our duplicitous and deliberately cryptic speech reminds me of our whirling dervishes, spinning like spindles of a thread, weaving us hymns worthy of the most sophisticated oracles and artists. The word dervish means indigent, ascetic, a recluse, someone rare, that is our sophist. And since we have invoked the order of the dervishes, it is only appropriate to quote their headmaster. Halaj said, Ana al-Haq, I am God, the law, the truth. We can already hear the shrieks and cries of heresy from the uninitiated against our heretics, our satyrs. But we take shelter in the words of our bard and criminal on the cross. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. The words heresy and heretic derive from the Greek word ereo, meaning to take, seize, win, gain, to grasp by the mind, to understand, to choose and to select. Itself from a root bearing the sense to take, grasp, and seize. And it also gives us our English words insult and consult. As in when beasts insult the oracles, and when oracles consult the gods, or when the satyrs do both. Now it's no coincidence here that the root sense for heresy overlaps with the sense of our root for the word captivating, the happenings of the poet's vessel. As Nietzsche puts it, the enormous horror which seizes people, namely the heretical responsibility of having now to choose, when they suddenly become confused and lose faith in the cognitive forms of the phenomenal world, because the principle of sufficient reason, that is everything that occurs must have a cause or a purpose, in one or other of its modes, appears to sustain an exception. Now the word horror, meaning shaking, shivering, and a chill, is derived from a root bearing the sense to be rigid, stiff, and surprised, giving us the Sanskrit root hrish, to be excited, impatient, anxious, rejoiced, thrilled, and aroused. The word exception is again derived from our familiar root for inception and conception, the happenings of the poet's vessel. Now later we will see how this underlying imagery of exception to the rule, as they pertain to the principle of sufficient reason, become particularly contentious in relation to concerns like free will and volitional choice, which are all tied up with concerns of having to take absolute responsibility. Note here that the sense of being released or freed is found in our root for the word slack and sleep, a motif we'll return to shortly. If we add to this horror the blissful ecstasy which arises from the innermost ground of man, indeed of nature itself, whenever this breakdown of the principium individuationis occurs, we catch a glimpse of the essence of the Dionysiac, which is best conveyed by the analogy of intoxication. The word intoxication derives from two roots, the first bearing the sense to run and flow, giving us the Greek word toxon, meaning a bow or a rainbow, an arch, something bowed or arched, from which we derive the word toxikos, meaning belonging to a bow or being skilled in archery. And further, the word toxikon, meaning the poison on the tip of the darts, and recall that the root for the word poison is to drink, and gave us our word symposium. And the Latin word toxico, meaning to smear or anoint with poison. The second root is our familiar one bearing the sense of in, inner, within, and inside, thus meaning to stupefy, that is to make speechless, to excite to enthusiasm or madness, and to invoke the inner rainbow. As the Skalds clearly put it, this rainbow is the sign of the covenant. Cleanse the guilt from the stained lips of the Theo, O forgiving sage. The word Theo, meaning servant and slave, is derived from our root for the word intoxication, as is the Sanskrit root thuk, meaning to rush, flee, run, and flow, and the Latin taxus, meaning a yew or a javelin made of wood of the sacred yew tree. Now to tidy up some of the imagery here, note that the root sense for the word poison is to drink, a word itself derived from a root bearing the sense to pull, draw, and drag, and glide, giving us the Sanskrit root drudge, to glide and to swoop. Now there's much more to be said about the role of the inner rainbow, gliding and swooping from the mouths of the sages, weaving wisdom to appear before our eyes, evidently helping us heretics catch a glimpse of the essence. Note that even the translator of Nietzsche stumbled upon our mantra, Esi is Capi, to catch a glimpse of the essence of the Dionysiac. The word glimpse, meaning a brief look or glance, a faint idea, or a pratibha, a flash of understanding, is derived from a root bearing the sense to shine, glow, warm, be bright, to be clear, evident, and the twilight. Again, imagery overlapping with the name of our devas. We also derive our English words gleam, glimmer, glisten, glitter, and the word gloom, wherefore we obtain our twilight imagery most explicitly, dimness, obscurity, and gloaming, meaning the twilight, the dusk, and the dawn. As Virgil put it in the Aeneid, go deep into the gloom of the grove and find the golden bow. Sacred to Juno, snap off a branch for lovely Proserpina who demands such offering. Now we'll return to our bow shortly, but note that with the sonoric sound change, we can couple our familiar root for Grita, Garma, and Christ with that for our root for glimpse and gloom. Now this imagery of intoxication is reminiscent of the exceptionally sophisticated ones, pouring forth a thrilling horror that seizes individuals, throwing them into a state of enthusiasm. And surely enough, the Soma hymn of the Kashyapas bear this imagery. The pressers propel your sap in their arms for ardent exhilaration. The sun's horse charges like a surge of waters. First note that the word pra comes from our root pr, for Apollo, with Jameson and Brereton invoke here as propel, driving and thrusting forward through a perilous journey for ardent exhilaration. The word ardent, meaning burning and glowing, is invoked in our Sanskrit word grishvi, also meaning lively, and derives from a root bearing the sense to rub, brush, polish, grind, crush, and pound. Itself from a root bearing the sense to rub, scrape, and scratch. Imagery certainly telling of the acts of catharsis of the Vishvedeva. Now to preserve this link, we'll merely make a note to join up the roots hrish and grish. Next, we find our root for the word intoxication in the word takti, for which the translators invoke the word charges, and recall from our previous lecture that the words horse, course, chariot, charge, and rush derive from a root bearing the sense to run, be quick, and to be lively. A sense that overlaps with both our roots for thuk, meaning to rush, flee, run, and flow, and our word grishvi. Now what's interesting is that the invocation of etasha, the sun's horse,
alongside the words rush and charge. And now, with the etymology, we know exactly why. Lastly, the word surge, our upright devoted thought thinking back to what is to be thought, is invoked for the Sanskrit word sarga, meaning an emission, creation, a stream, or a downpour, which is derived from a root srij, meaning to let go, discharge, to throw, to cast, to hurl, to emit, and to pour, itself from a root bearing the sense to throw away, to pour out, to release, and to set free. Thus the word sulk. Again, the injunction pouring forth from the mouth of Brahma to release the sinner with an exception. Now, to complement the dream as a household, we will establish intoxication as the wilderness, both coupled here to represent the depths of the imagery being invoked in the poet's vessel. In this regard, we can invoke one of the Elohim and quote their poems. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshipper, lover of leaving, it doesn't matter. Ours is not a caravan of despair. Come, even if you have broken your vows 1,000 times. Now, speaking of the fulfillment of broken vows, it would be unfortunate to have invoked the golden bow without quoting the frenzied phraser, James, who dedicated an entire study on the matter, relating Brahma's seminar pouring into the poet's vessel, with their agrarian fertility cults throwing seeds onto kshetras. Although Fraser is often cited by atheists and anti-Christians to revel in the fact of the mundaneness of religious myths, the high priests remind these bearers of negation that the word myth and mundane derive from the same root, bearing the sense to wash and wetten, a similar sense to our word snata, one who has bathed or been purified or become well-versed in the symbolic histories. A myth, then, is the most mundane production, sophisticated speech adorned and embellished with mysteries, poured forth as drink and song. Now, Fraser believed that the origins of all religious and poetic myths could be traced to some primal imagery pertaining to fertility rituals, where an ancient man worshipped the periodic nature of birth, growth, death, and the eventual rebirth. And this cyclical rhythm sustained a dialogue about the nature of the dialectic, which resulted in either survival or complete ruin. Now, for us, the motif of fertility is certainly appropriate, insofar as the seed and the semen are the seminar. But we are more interested in the dialectic between teachers and disciples, between freemen and slaves. As Virgil tells us, the Trojan hero Aeneas, having arrived at the gates of the sophisticated underworld, seeks admittance to Hades so that he may consult the spirit of his deceased father, Incaeus. Nearby, the Sibyl, or the prophetess, instructs Aeneas how to accomplish this task, which we have already read. Go deep into the gloom of the grove and find the golden bow sacred to Juno. Snap off a branch for lovely Proserpina, who demands such offering. Aeneas acts as instructed, and having successfully picked the golden bow, presents it to Proserpina at the gates, and is granted admittance to Hades, and ultimately finds his father, who prophesizes the founding of Rome. Romulus and Remus, the legendary founders of Rome, are direct descendants of Aeneas. Fraser further elaborates on the details of this myth, writing, within the sanctuary at Lake Nemi, that is the Grove of Diana, grew a certain tree, of which no branch might be broken. Only a runaway slave was allowed to break off, if he could, one of its boughs. Success in the attempt entitled him to fight the priest in single combat, and if he slew him, he reigned in his stead with the title King of the Wood. First, we note that the name of the Grove of Diana is Nemi, which is derived from the Greek word nemos, which we saw last lecture coming from our root nim, bearing the sense to distribute, give, take, reciprocate, to bend, curve, and turn. Imagery, which is reminiscent of poetry and catharsis, marking off the sacred site of the sacrifice. The name Diana literally means divine, since her name comes from the same root as the words divine and Zeus, our root which bears the imagery of prophecy, shining, glowing, and clarifying. This imagery of prophecy in Diana is unsurprising, as we know that she is the Roman equivalent of Apollo's divine twin sister, Artemis, goddess of the hunt, the wilderness, and the mistress of the animals, whom we saw last lecture was given the epithet Eoquira, she who pours forth arrows. Second, we see here the invocation of the imagery of the runaway slave. Recalling that our root for intoxication gave us the English word theo, meaning servant and slave,
running forth to the inner sanctuary of the mind, the heart, and the grove par excellence. As the story goes, this wandering slave seeks to fight the high priest in mode of combat, a mode of frenzy characteristic of the Manyu, mood, passion, anger, and wrath of Rudra. Note we also derive the Greek word mainomai, to be mad, angry, and enraged, giving us our words mania and manic. And it is this state of mania wherein the freeman and the slave, high priest and monk, teacher and disciple, engage in ultimate warfare, establishing the sacrificial altar, giving and taking in a reciprocal dialogue that results in praises and prizes for one party, or the complete ruin of both. Fraser describes this as the periodic worship and sacrifice of a sacred king, our Fremdling, as he continues, according to the public opinion of the ancients, the fateful branch was the golden bow, which at the Sibyl's bidding, Aeneas plucked before he essayed the perilous journey to the world of the dead. First, we note here that the word perilous and fear are derived from the same root as our Fremdling, Apollo, and the word journey from our root for prophecy. Second, the word bow derives from a root bearing the sense to grow strong, thick, large, abundant, and corpulent, and gives us our Sanskrit root bah, meaning to grow, increase, strengthen, and make firm, and thus the word bahu, meaning arm or the limb of a bow. We saw the Kashyapas invoking the arms to propel the sap of the sapling with the word oni. The golden bow clearly possesses a sap needing extraction, soma, as the Brahmins say. Interestingly, in keeping with the imagery of the perilous journey to enter among the ranks of the title of the high priests, Aeneas's act of plucking brings to mind our root vrij, to bend, turn, twist, pluck, gather, pick, and choose, which we immediately recognize as catharsis, and the picking and choosing here being our heretics, the chosen ones. It's unsurprising to see Pravargya and our red earthen vessel, the Mahavira, the poet's vessel, invoked to signify the Elohim, lopping the trees of the grove. For why break off a tree branch and then confront a fight to the death, if not for poesis? We can summarize these glimpses of mythic imagery by singing Krishna's Yajurveda. Namaste Rudra Manyava Hutata Yishave Namaha. Namaste Astu Dhanvane Vahutya Mutate Namaha. Returning to Nietzsche, these Dionysiac stirrings, which as they grow in intensity cause subjectivity to vanish to the point of complete self-forgetting, awaken either under the influence of narcotic drink, of which all human beings and peoples who are close to the origin of things speak in their hymns, or at the approach of spring, when the whole of nature is pervaded by lust for life. The act of self-forgetting is imagery reminiscent of Lemosyne, lulling the ego into latency so that the horror may seize the self, generating a narcotic dream for the sophisticated bards, and for us, the heretic, our celestial nymph. The word narcotic is derived from a root bearing the sense to turn, bend, twist, and constrict, giving us the English word narrow and the Greek word narki, meaning lethargic, torpor, numb, and dull. Interestingly, we also derive the Sanskrit word nrit, meaning to dance or to act upon a stage. The word dance itself, in keeping with the imagery of threads twisting and twining and being drawn out and stretched, is derived as an extension of our root for the words think, thought, and tones, from a root bearing the sense to draw, pull, stretch out, and to gesture, giving us our Sanskrit root tans, meaning to adorn, decorate, shake, and to pour out wishes, requests, and desires. To dance, then, is simultaneously the rhythmic steps performed to oracular songs, which we may in a more competitive light, keeping the imagery of the golden bow in mind, say is a battle of wits. Again, our whirling dervish twisting and bending like the streams of soma gushing forth from Brahma's mouth, catching a glimpse of the essence of the primal semen. Singing and dancing, man expresses his sense of belonging to a higher community. His gestures speak of his enchantment. We find here expressed in Nietzsche the same sentiment we saw in Slavoj Žižek, speaking of the death of God being the moment at the cross of absolute freedom. Recalling that the root for the words free, freedom, and friend bear the sense to love, please, and gladden, and gives us our Sanskrit root
pri, to please, delight, comfort, love, and adore, and thus prema, love, joy, affection, care, and gaiety. Again, imagery of adorning and decorating, overlapping for our root for the word dance, giving depth and clarity to the bard of Bengal's utterance, in thy dance, divine dancer, freedom finds its image and dreams their forms. Its cadence weaves the threads of things and unwinds them for ages. As the translator of Nietzsche puts it, man is no longer an artist. He has become a work of art. All nature's artistic power reveals itself here, amid shivers of intoxication, to the highest, most blissful satisfaction of the primordial unity. Here man, the noblest clay, the most precious marble, is kneaded and carved out, to the accompaniment of the chisel blows of the Dionysiac world artist. The call of the Eleusinian mysteries rings out. The artist is in fact our Aryan, our Fremdling, our runaway slave, fit for battle with the high priest, seeking to snap the bow, gring, in the grove, the sanctuary of our stranger, the hostess with the mostess, to delight the eternal sap, the creative juices flowing forth from the origin, both drink and song, O matato brahmajitnyasa. This liberality of our exceptional artist, who speaks of peaks, is derived from a root bearing the sense to grow up, to sprout, to climb, to arrive, and to reach, giving us our Sanskrit root, rud, to sprout, shoot, grow up, and the Latin, liber, to be free, independent, exempt, and void. In Greek, we derive the verb, eleutho, meaning to come and to go, as in the imperatives, go away, and come here, utterances of deliverance from bad habits in speech, thought, and action. This is evident from the derivative word, Eleutheros, meaning freedom and our freemen, and having invoked the Eleusinian, we find the word Eleusis, meaning coming, arrival, and advent, to denote manifestation of idols and ideas within the poet's vessel. So again, what is freedom? It is an intricate dance, an intoxicating dialogue, an inspiring dialectic, orchestrated between our bard and Lady Dawn, both bearing for us unfathomable insights to perpetually journey to and fro the grove, never to get lost at sea. In a previous lecture, we questioned the role of dancing in poesis. Perhaps we can tentatively suggest that dance, being the orchestration of rhythmic steps to the stirrings of the inner rainbow, the oracular songs, is the original site of embodied poesy. In fact, the totality of collectivity, being called higher community by Nietzsche, the Holy Spirit by Slavoj, and the Breath Force by Peglia, is but a dance twisting and bending back and forth between the household and the wilderness both. To this effect, Nietzsche summarizes the dialectic as follows. The Apolline art of the image maker or sculptor and the imageless art of music, which is that of Dionysus. Again, we find here the coupling of image and sound, characteristic of prophetic speech, our Sandhya Bhasha. He continues, in order to gain a closer understanding of these two drives, let us think of them in the first place as separate art worlds of dream and intoxication. Between these two physiological phenomena, an opposition can be observed, which corresponds to that between the Apolline and the Dionysiac. So let's end this lecture with the erotic, our lust for the original spring, for Rishi Nam Rishitvam, the godhood of the gods. Recall the word red, earth, and rare, derived from a root bearing the sense to be dark red and dusk red, to which we can now add the acts to parse, crumble, and to fall to pieces, and from which we derive the word erotic, and our Sanskrit root ranj, to color, dye, redden, be excited and to glow, indicative of our Ram, our glowing hot Pravargya, belonging to the first class, a rare one set apart from all others since the inner rainbow pours into his vessel and the ragas pour out from his lotus mouth. Thus having invoked Hare Rama Hare Krishna, it's only appropriate we supplement the household and the wilderness with the appropriate Vaishnava and Shaiva imagery, between rest and digest and fight and flight,
seeking for ourselves the Holy Trinity of Brahma pouring forth the seminar of Vishnu and Shiva partaking in the birth, growth, decay, death, and eventual rebirth of all poetic drinks and songs. To bring these poetics home to their origins, back into the poet's well-baked red earthen vessel, we note that the words oral and origin are derived from our familiar root bearing the sense to move, stir, rise, to spring, to quarrel, fight, evoke, to bring forth, and to produce, which we saw gave us our Sanskrit root arsh, to gush or rush forth, to flow swiftly, to swoop, dart, and shoot down. And keeping our sound change rules in mind, we find that arsh is coupled to our root rish, meaning to drink and to pour out praises in the form of a song. Thus the name of our vipras, sages and seers, rishi. This interpretation can be supported with the help of Tatiana Elizenrenkova, who describes the act of poesis as follows. All this exegesis seems to confirm the hypothesis that the semantics of the verb arsh in the Rig Veda is very closely connected with the ritual in general, and more particularly with the soma sacrifice. Soma passing through the sheep wool strainer flowed into the wooden vessel. The priest tasted it, and the hallucinogenic liquid sharpened his intuition so that the truth was momentarily revealed in him. Having seen it, and having given it the shape of a hymn, the priest Rishi filtered poetic speech through his heart and let it flow freely in order to enable it to reach the divine and heavenly sphere. This ritual orientation of the verb arsh could give rise to the nominal derivative, Rishi, with its complex semantics. A participant in a rite who drinks the sacrificial liquid and pours out praises in the form of a hymn. This pouring forth of musical and metrical praises to invoke Namasini, the lady of the heart, Aranyani, is clearly language, invoking the gods at the sacrifice, praises, giving prizes aplenty. For this we sing.
Bhadram karne bhishrunuyama deva bhadram pashye vakshabhir yajatra.
Might we hear auspicious with our ears, O gods, might we see auspicious with our eyes, O you who are worthy of sacrifice. Deriving names from nouns and nouns from words, and words from verbs and verbs from roots, is akin to diverting and turning the course of a stream, whose origins mark the spring around which the daughters of Namasini, the muses, dance. In fact, this is what we mean when we use the word derive, which is derived from our root giving us our word's origin in oral. To derive names is to recognize their nature as diversions of a stream pouring forth from the oral cavity of the rishi. As Nietzsche puts it, originally, as we have seen, it is language which works on building the edifice of concepts. Later, it is science. This makes sense, for before there is ever conception, there must be a reception. And before both, there is language, pouring and gushing forth into the vessel as drink and song. Now, this use of language may be extremely obtuse and obscure for those seeking to take in more than a glimpse at a time, despite being untrained in the art of language, the art of invocation. Such weavers are forever lost at sea, unaware of the nature of their own vessel, and so we take caution from the editors and translators of Nietzsche's Birth of Tragedy, reminding us that Nietzsche's use of language in the Birth of Tragedy differs from that of most philosophers in certain respects, most notably in the extent to which his arguments rely on the poetic devices of metaphor, etymological linkage, and wordplay. These peculiarities create difficulties for translators and readers alike, since the English equivalent seldom conveys the multi-layered character of the original German, and thus obscures the patterns Nietzsche creates from the German terms. By settling eventually on the Birth of Tragedy as the title of his first book, Nietzsche drew attention to the imagery of sexuality and reproduction, which pervades it, in elaboration of Schopenhauer's assertion that sex is the Brennpunkt des Willens, the focus of the will. Like Fraser, a contemporary of Nietzsche, the latter too stumbled upon the imagery of the pouring of the primal seminar into the red earthen vessel, the yoni, and how this act of creation was reminiscent of the lewdness and liberality of sexuality. Now, the word sexuality is derived from the same root as carnality, carnival, and crisis, perhaps unsurprisingly. The imagery of the root for liberality to grow up and to sprout is clearly speaking to the developmental procedure whereby boys become men and girls become women. All in all, sexual maturity, a cutting or division into males and females. So in spirit of the ancestors, we pour our libations to the sexual liberation established by the ascetics. For now, we reflect on our ability to catch a glimpse of the essence of language, the verb roots. Pag pag dolo re ho, pag pag dolo re, dag mag si main chalti ho, jag mag lo si jalti tere naino ki kaisi madhya thar thar ka pore tere tir se chipti chandan pe naag si lipti main behosh tu nasha aisi moh ki dasha mera chain rehne ne apne saath.